الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك لا إله لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا بما ينفعنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعل القرآن حجة لنا ولا علينا يا رب العالمين. ويذكر سبحانه وتعالى that he grants us beneficial knowledge, knowledge of his book, knowledge of his speech, and that he increases us in goodness, in khayr, good deeds, iman, taqwa, and anything which brings us to his pleasure. And likewise we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes the Qur'an as a proof for us and not against us. With the grace of Allah, we thank him alone, and then the Masjid Community Center. For nearly 1 year now, we've been going through regular lessons every single Sunday, and we've managed to cover a great deal of goodness. For example, we've been through the kitab of the strangers and Ghuraba by Al-Ajurri, something in Aqeelah, something in Manhaj. Then we did something in Hadith, Tib al-Nabawi, by Diyaddin al-Maqdisi. Then we looked at the stories of the prophets, from the book of Ibn Kathir. Then we looked at the seerah of the Khulafa al-Rashidin from Seerah Alam al-Nubala. And then we went through something in Adab and Akhlaq and Fiqh. So when the masjid were thinking, okay, what's the next thing that we want to cover? It's something either between Aqeedah, because we haven't done Aqeedah in a while, something a bit more specific on Aqeedah, or something in Qur'an Tafsir. And the committee of the Masjid, Jazakumullah Khair, decided that in keeping with the theme of the previous book, Fusul al-Adab by Ibn Aqeel, chapters in Goodly Manners and Character by Ibn Aqeel, and in order for us to cover something different, tafsir would be something which is good. And this is important because a lot of people ask, I want to become a better Muslim, I want to study, I want to, you know, aspire to be better and improve. What do you advise? This question comes a lot in the UK, it comes a lot around the world. And there is no scholar, except that they will tell you to start with the Book of Allah. The Qur'an has been sent to us as a guidance. It's not a book of mathematics, not a book of geometry or geography or history. It's not a book of theology in the sense of philosophy and trying to extrapolate theological and theoretical and philosophical arguments. It's a book of guidance. It says in the Quran, Alif Lam Ra, Kitabun Anzalnahu Ilayka Litukhrijan Nas Min Al-Dhulumati Ila Nur Bi Ibn Rabbihim Ila Sirat Al-Aziz Al-Hamid. It is a book that Allah has revealed so that mankind, through the guidance of Allah that can be found in this book, are shifted from darkness into light. They are guided, they are shown a way to the right way, to the way of illumination from darkness, to a way of tranquility and ease from a place of tightness and difficulty, from shirk to Tawheed, from disobedience to obedience, from Bid'ah to Sunnah, bi'idhni Rabbihim, with the permission of their Lord, with the guidance of their Lord, ila Sirat al-Aziz al-Hamid, to the path of Al-Aziz and the path of Al-Hamid, the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, when we understand this introduction, and we can see the reasoning as to where we are going with these lectures, it makes it more than sensible, and it makes it good reasoning where a person can then think is that doing tafsir is very, very important. And it is the cornerstone and the bedrock and the foundation for all forms of guidance. So in this lecture, inshaAllah, we are going to look at some of the benefits of studying the Qur'an and why this topic is so important. And inshaAllah, from next week, what we will do is we will start looking at a surah from the surahs of the Qur'an which have a heavy emphasis on akhlaq. And like we said, this is in line with where the masjid are going with this, because the previous book was a book on akhlaq, and now we want something on akhlaq, but also something a bit different from a different discipline from the sciences of the sharia, so something in tafsir. So is there where we confuse tafsir with akhlaq? Yes. Surah Al-Hujarat. So inshaAllah, in the coming weeks, we're going to be looking at, inshaAllah, the tafsir of Surah Al-Hujarat, taken from the tafsir of Imam Abdul Rahman ibn Nasir al-Sa'di, the Sheikh of Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen. But we will also do, may Allah mercy on them all, but what we will also do is look at tafsir and benefits that we can gain from other books of tafsir and other books of benefits surrounding these ayat, inshaAllah. So then, why is the Qur'an so important? Why is tafsir so important? The Qur'an is important because it gives the person ilm, and it gives him the correct perspective in life and the perspective in anything that he wants to attain. Allah says in the Qur'an, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has come a nur. And again, we saw nur in one of the ayat that we just quoted earlier. Is that it's an illumination, it takes you away from darkness, it takes you away from misguidance, it takes you away from ignorance, and it gives you steadfastness, it gives you uprightness, it gives you insight. Wa kitabun mubin, nurun wa kitabun mubin, a light and a clear book. What happens when you have that light and the clear book? If you accept it and you act upon it, يهدي به الله من اتبع رضوانه سبل السلام. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will assist you and show you the right way to attain His pleasure and to attain His Jannah. وَيُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ بِإِذْنِ وَيَهْدِيهِمْ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Allah also says another place in the Qur'an, قَدْ فَصَّلْنَا الْآيَاتِ. Allah has explained His ayat, لِقَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ, for the people of knowledge. Qur'an is important because it gives you knowledge. Qur'an gives you perspective. Because Allah says in this ayat, like many ayats from the Qur'an, that the ayat in this book, the messages in this book, in it is knowledge, in it is obedience, and it is only the people who want to attain that knowledge that will be benefiting from its signs and its guidance. قَدْ فَصُلْنَا, these ayat have been explained, قَدْ فَصُلْنَا الْآيَاتِ, in detail, so that there is nothing unclear left about it, there is nothing obscure, there is nothing which is doubtful. Its tawheed is clear, its aqeedah is clear, its manhaj is clear, its practical rulings are clear, the messages of the previous nations are clear, Jannah and its path to Jannah is clear, the way to stay away from the hellfire is clear, how to improve and increase in yourself in goodness is clear in all aspects. قَدْ فَصَّلْنَا الْآيَاتِ, but for who? لِقَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ, for the people of knowledge. So if you want knowledge and you want Allah's guidance and you want to be taken away from darkness into light, or partial darkness into full light, or there's a little bit of darkness in your life and you want that to be removed also. Darkness is relative. It could be a lot, it could be a little. It's in the Qur'an. But Allah only grants this detail and this guidance for the people who want the knowledge. لِكَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ. The Qur'an is important because it brings about blessings. Allah says in the Qur'an, كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكُمْ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that we have given you a book revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself, which tells us that it is uncreated speech of Allah, and it has come from outside of the creation of Allah. كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. It is blessed. It is blessed in its meaning. So when you accept this knowledge and you accept this correct perspective, you change. You become better. You leave the dhulumat and you go into the nur. You leave those things which are holding you back and you head to liberate yourself, fleeing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, leaving your desires and the shayateen behind. It removes anxiety, it removes depression, it removes any kind of negativity that a person can ever feel in the dunya. Why wouldn't it? Because it is a book which takes people into guidance, which is the path, يهدي بهم السبل السلام. It takes them to the path of salam. Therefore this book is blessed in its meaning and is blessed also in its reward. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلمه. Therefore, in order for you to become the best of all people from this ummah, and look at the hadith from the Prophet ﷺ, who is he talking to? He's talking to the companions. So the companions are already the best of all people after the prophets and the messengers. But he said, from you are not all the same. The best from the companions, khayrukum, mean from you, the companions, are those man ta'allama al-Qur'an wa 'allamahu, learn the Qur'an, and then they teach it to other people. Therefore, in order for you to be blessed in its meanings, you have to learn it. But then when you learn it and you attain that nur, and you attain that perspective, and you attain that guidance and that knowledge, you become the best of people. Therefore, you become blessed. So not only is it blessed in its recitation, but it's blessed in its knowledge, and it's blessed in its practice. But even if, now this is the virtue of this book, even if a person, and this is not by the way of condoning, but this is just showing you the virtue, even if a person was just to recite this book, recite its ayat, without knowing what it actually means, then even that is blessed. Because the ulama have said categorically, the best form of dhikr and the best form of remembering Allah, and the best thing that you could do with your tongue, is to recite the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man qara'a harfan min kitabillah falahum bihi hasana." Whoever recites a letter from the Quran, a letter. And there is khilaf between the ulama. Are the harakat included in that? So the fatha and the kasra and the dhammatain, wathatain, kasratain, all these different idgham and idhar and all these different things that we add to combining letters, does that increase a person in the reward, or is it just per letter? And some of them, such as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said each harf referring to each blocks of words, meaning as in each minimum word. How can you use this? Harf. So for example, if a person says alam, meaning alif lam mim, With Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he said that these are two harf, a and lam. A meaning harf, meaning, but lam is a word in itself. Therefore, he would call this as a preposition, and this has its own reward. Whereas the majority of ulama have said alif is a harf, lam is a harf, and neem is a harf, based on this hadith found in Tirmidhi, where the Prophet ﷺ said, وَالْحَسَنَةُ بِأَشْرِ أَمْثَالِهَا. And when a person does a good deed, it is multiplied by 10. لَا أَقُولْ أَلَمْ حَرْفْ وَلَكِنْ. Allah says, the Prophet ﷺ said, I don't say alif lam mim is one harf. لَكِنْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفٌ وَمِيمٌ حَرْفٌ وَلَمْ حَرْفٌ. لَكِنْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفٌ وَاللَّامٌ حَرْفٌ وَمِيمٌ حَرْفٌ. Rather, I say alif is a harf, lam is a harf, and mim is a harf. So each single letter, you will carry reward. Some of the ulama have said, if it's got more to do with the pronunciation of that letter, based on the rules of tajweed and qira'ah, then you'll get more of a reward. And like we said, Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, everyone has their own ijtihad. Some of them have said that every harf is a reward, meaning every preposition, meaning every minimum word has its own reward. So a and lam in the Arabic language could mean something. It does make a sentence. So now that sentence can be categorized into two, because that has a separate meaning and that has a separate clause and that has a separate clause. So Ibn Taymiyyah says Alam refers to two. Whereas the majority, looking at this hadith, is quite clear, lakin alifun harf, lamun harf, mimun harf. Every single letter brings about it. So now, the point that we're making is that this book is blessed. It's blessed in its meanings. It's blessed in its guidance. It's blessing when you are acting upon it. It changes who you are. It makes you a better person. It gives you perspective. It makes you the best of the best. It makes you the best of those people who are around. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعْلِمُ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best of you are those who learn the Qur'an and then teach it. And it is the best form of dhikr. Because from its blessings is that whenever you recite it, you will get a multiplication in its reward. It is so blessed that even just listening to it being recited, you get a reward. Just listening to it attentively, you get a reward. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنَ. When the Quran is being recited, فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ. Listen to it. وَأَنْصِتُوا. Listen to it and remain quiet. Pay attention towards the recitation of the Quran. What happens? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Surely you'll be shown mercy through this. You're not even reciting. You're not even learning, perhaps. All you are doing is you are listening. Now this is like we said before, not by the way of condoning, because there is no difference between the ulama. That the reason why we have been given the Quran and our interaction with the Quran must be an interaction of learning and guidance. كتاب أنزلنا إليك مباركا ليتدبروا آياتي وليتذكروا أولو الألباب. Allah has told us that the reason why He has given this Quran is for us to ponder on it, and so that the people of understanding are reminded by it. كتاب أنزلناه إليك, a book that has been given and revealed upon you, لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور. The whole point of reciting this book is that we remove those ignorances and we move into the light, we move into guidance. But it is so blessed that even if a person was to read it without understanding or was to just hear it, they will have some kind of blessing given to them. The Quran is so blessed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised to preserve it and to preserve its people and those people who act upon it. And not much else has been given that guarantee, if anything has been given that guarantee. Inna nahnu nazzalna ilayka adh-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. We have revealed upon you the dhikr and we will protect it. We'll protect the book and we'll protect the people of the book. Meaning the followers and the reciters of the Quran. It is so blessed. It softens the heart. But the ulama have mentioned that the softening of the heart and accepting the guidance. So now your heart has to be soft in order for it to be soft even more. Otherwise, the nur and the hidayah will not penetrate. If your heart is hard, stubborn, arrogance, shirk, sins, bid'ah, not giving the Quran respect, not wanting to learn, not wanting to change, no sincerity, no submission, no certainty perhaps in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no love for Allah or His Messenger or His religion, no humility towards Him, no truthfulness towards Him. All of these have been mentioned as the conditions of the Shahada. In order for you to have a soft heart, there needs to be certain characteristics there in the first place. And if those are there, and then a person wants to benefit from the Qur'an, it will create even softer hearts. There's an example from Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is describing not the companions. He is describing some of the Christian priests when they hear the Quran being recited. What is their description? That they laugh, that they mock? No. Allah says, وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ. If they hear what has been recited upon the Rasul, وَإِذَا سَمِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ ترى أعينهم تفيد من الدمع مما عرفوا من الحق. You will find that their eyes will be weeping with tears because they know that this is the haqq. Isn't this true? Isn't Abu al-Najashi, when he had the Quran, he couldn't stop himself from crying. يقولون, and they say whilst they are weeping, whilst they are hearing the Quran being recited, ربنا آمنا, our Lord, we have believed. فَاكْتُبْنَا مَعَ الشَّاهِدِينَ. Make us of those who have witnessed. Softness. When they hear the Qur'an being recited, their hearts tremble. Something happens inside of them. It reduces people. It creates submission. And part of why we are studying what we are studying in the surah that we have taken is that with this softness, it creates manners. It creates akhlaq. It creates certainty. It creates tawakkul. And with that, anxieties and difficulties are removed. تَرَعَيُنُ تَفِيدُ مِنَ الدَّمِي مِمَّا عَرَفُ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. You will see them weeping because they know that this is the truth. They are rejoicing. They are weeping because this is moving them. They are weeping because they know that in this is goodness. They know that in this is their salvation. The person who recites the Quran is a person who has the angels descend upon him. So don't think whilst you're reciting the Quran nothing's happening. No. The angels descend upon him. It's from the hadith of Ali ibn Abi Talib. It's been classed as Hassan by Sheikh Al-Albani. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Innal abd idha tasawwaka thumma qama yusalli qama al-malik khalfa fayastami' liqira'atihi." From the adab and the manners that a person must have when worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he makes himself presentable in front of his Lord. The Prophet ﷺ is saying here that if a person makes siwak, he cleans his mouth, perhaps even just gargles his mouth, so that when he is about to recite, there are no foul smells. And then he stands and he starts to recite from the Book of Allah. Now, inshallah, this is included in a person reciting in salah, but hopefully we have good thoughts in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this could also include anyone who recites the Quran. But in this hadith, the Prophet is saying here, and when a person cleans his mouth, he stands to pray. Qam al-Maliku Khalfa, an angel comes and he stands behind him whilst he is praying. فَيَسْتَمِعْ لِقِرَاتِ, and he is listening to him recite. فَيَدْنُ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَلِمَةٌ نَحْوَ حَتَّى يَدَ فَاهُ عَلَى فِيهِ. When he begins to recite, the angel is hearing him, the angel is hearing him. And every time that the angel is listening to this person recite the Qur'an, look at the barakah of the Qur'an, look what it does to an angel. The angel draws closer towards the recitation of the Qur'an. He loves it. And he draws closer towards the recitation of the Qur'an. Until to the extent that the person who is reciting the Qur'an, the angel will place his mouth on top of the mouth of the person who is reciting the Qur'an. فَمَا يَخْرُجْ مِنْ فِيهِ شَيْءٍ مِنْ الْقُرْآنِ إِلَّا صَارَ فِي جَوْفِ الْمَلِكِ. To the extent then, that the more he recites the Qur'an, that recitation is going inside of the body of the angel. And that angel accompanies you until you finish reciting the Qur'an. A person might think, okay, well, that's not something that I want. I don't want another thing's mouth on top of my mouth. But the Prophet ﷺ is actually explaining to us here that this is actually a great deal of khair for you. Number one, the angels, they don't have a gender. So it's not like it's a male or a female putting their mouth over your mouth. The angels don't have a gender. The angels don't have any sexual desires. The angels are close to Allah because they are creatures of obedience, of worship. The angels have their istighfar and dua and their acts of worship accepted with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you've got something so honorable with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala close to you, accompanying you, loving you, nurturing you, being with you, this is actually a veneration for the person who needs it, which is me and you. Because we are people who are deficient. We are people who get tired. We are people who don't remember Allah all the time, unlike the malaika. So that recitation goes inside the angel. And that angel wants to be with you whilst you are reciting the Quran. So what's the command from the Prophet? Look at the remainder of the hadith. فَطَهِّرُوا أَفْوَاهَكُمْ لِلْقُرْآنِ. So cleanse your mouths. Make your mouths clean. Now this could be interpreted before reciting the Qur'an or by reciting the Qur'an. Whatever the case, the angels are those who accompany the people of Qur'an. Now everything that we've looked at here in this introduction, in talking about the virtues of learning the Qur'an, everything is connected to so far what happens to the servant who recites the Qur'an in the dunya. He's given knowledge, he's given perspective whilst so many people remain in darkness. This person knows what he's doing, he becomes independent, he becomes guided from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has a purpose in life, he has an objective, he has goals, he is going somewhere. He becomes the best of people. He increases in barakah. Because now he is increasing in good. He's not just remaining stagnant. He's improving. in his knowledge, he's improving in his manners, he's improving in his worship, improving in his deeds. But then on top of that, he's improving and attaining from that barakah the ability to attain more rewards where other people might not be able to get that reward. And this is also very important, and it's advice to myself more than anybody else, that it is something that we can all then become relaxed in, including students of knowledge. You find a lot of people who feel that they are trying to benefit themselves and benefit the ummah, but they then neglect the Qur'an at the same time. So you'll find a lot of people on social media, you'll find a lot of people listening to durus, you'll find a lot of people reading, perhaps even writing. So many different things that people are interacting in when it comes to Islamic knowledge, which is all good, but if it comes at the price of not reciting the Qur'an, not understanding the Qur'an, not memorizing the Qur'an, not acting upon the Qur'an, then we are not from what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلِّمُ الْقُرْآنَ. You are the best of people who learn the Qur'an. وَعَلَّمَ. Therefore, there's a lot of blessings involved with the Qur'an. They increase in good deeds, they increase in reward. Now, blessings could be in being good and consistently good, but blessings can also be that a person finds a lot of khayr in something that they have done which is very small. So imagine a person dedicates his time in reciting the Qur'an for an hour a day, and in an hour he can perhaps do 4, 5, maybe 6 juz, maybe even 1 juz, maybe even half a juz. The barakah is not in the amount, not necessarily anyway. The barakah is in the fact that he will attain goodness from that very little that he has put forth. Kitabun anzalna ilayk mubarak. It's a blessed book. It's blessed in the way that you practice it, and it's also blessed in every single interaction that you have with it, so that you increase in its reward. مَنْ كَرَأْ حَرْفَ مِنْ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ فَلَهُ حَسَنًا. Every single letter brings a reward. وَالْحَسَنَ بِأَشْرِ أَمْثَالِهَا. So now just in the Fatiha, there are hundreds of letters. And you times that by 10, therefore, barakah now is in the ilm, but also the way that you use your time. Just to give you an example, if you've got an hour and you listen to hadith, and you've got an hour and you listen to read the Qur'an, the hour with the Qur'an, inshaAllah, is perhaps more blessed. It creates a person to be preserved, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised to preserve the Qur'an, and that comes with the people of the Qur'an. It softens the heart, and through it, the angels accompany the person who recites the Quran. All of this is from the dunya. What about the akhirah? The Prophet ﷺ said, "Iqra'u al-Quran, recite the Quran. Be plentiful in reciting the Quran. فَإِنَّهُ يَأْتِي يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. The Quran will come on the day of judgment. شَفِيعٌ لِأَصْحَابِهِ. شَفِيعٌ. It will come as an interceder, as a protector, as a barrier between the person who used to recite the Qur'an and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or it could be that the person is good and he's going to Jannah anyway, shafi'an li ashabi, so that you are elevated. Point number one, the akhirah, the Qur'an will accompany you. It will accompany in your grave, it will accompany when you are resurrected. Point number two from the Akhirah, reciting the Qur'an, acting upon the Qur'an, meaning that you will have a higher station in Jannah above anyone else. Now from this hadith that we were going to quote, there is a glad tidings, and again this is not to condone that we become relaxed, and this is not to encourage that at all. But this following hadith, Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said that it is not specific to the Huffaz. Just like we said that reciting the Quran without knowing its knowledge and knowing and understanding its tafsir, etc., will give you the reward anyway. But that's not encouraging that behavior. Listening to the Quran, and perhaps you think, okay, well, I can just listen to the Quran. With the Qur'an, فَاسْتَمِعُونَ سِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. I will attain Allah's mercy, and I don't need to recite the Qur'an, I can just listen to it. No, that's not the point. And perhaps if a person has that kind of a mindset, it could also then be possible that that person might not attain the good rewards that are found in those evidences, because he is on purpose being lazy. But just by reciting the Qur'an, and perhaps say you didn't understand something, you'll get that reward inshaAllah. Just by listening to the Qur'an, and say you don't have the ability to recite it, or the ability to recite it currently, you inshaAllah, you get the reward. And likewise in this hadith, you might not be a hafiz, but you are trying. You might never become a hafiz, but you want to, and you are trying, and Allah knows best. Abdullah ibn Amr, and narrated, this is from Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood and others, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُقَال لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ, it will be said to the person of Qur'an. And this is why Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said that it's not specific to the Huffaz. لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ, the person who was connected to the Qur'an. And Allah knows whether you are a person who is connected to the Qur'an or not. This is something between you and Allah. يُقَال لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ, it will be said to the person of the Qur'an, اِقْرَأْ وَرْتَقِي وَرَتِّلْ, recite and continue reciting, and recite in a beautiful manner. كَمَا كُنْتَ تُرَتِّلْ فِي الدُّنْيَا, in this version here, كَمَا كُنْتَ تُرَتِّلْ فِي الدُّنْيَا, in another narration, كَمَا كُنْتَ تَقْرَأَهَا فِي الدُّنْيَا, recite it as you used to recite it in the dunya. The different versions now, as you used to recite it in the dunya, or turattil, as you used to recite it in a slow and a beautiful, measured manner like you used to do in the dunya. It will be said to this person, recite the Quran on the Day of Judgment. Whilst everybody is in chaos, unsurety, anxiety, punishment, regret, remorse, the person who had a connection with the Qur'an on the Day of Judgment, he'll be calm. And Allah will say to him, and it will be said to him, read the Qur'an. Just like you used to do before, just be calm. Recite in the way that you used to, like you used to do when you were in your bedroom, or where you used to be in your office, or in your lounge, or wherever it is. Just how you used to do, just how it was. Just do that again. فَإِنَّ آخِرٌ, surely the last place where you stop, مَنْزِلَكَ إِنَّ آخِرٌ آيَةِ تَخْرُوْهَا, surely your status will be the last ayah that you recite from the Qur'an. So if you had memorized the whole Qur'an, you will continue elevating until you have finished reciting. How many ayahs in the Qur'an? Roughly around 6,000. So you'll be said to you on the Day of Judgment, recite the Qur'an, and every time you recite, you go up a stage until you have elevated 6,000 rankings. 6,000 stages, and that will be where you are from the highest stations in Jannah. But as the hadith says, يُقَال لِصَاحِبِ الْقُرْآنِ, it will be said to the person who recites the Qur'an, inshaAllah, as Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said, the main thing here is the interaction with the Qur'an, and not necessarily the hifz, but this is not to make people lazy, but the point here is that it gives a person optimism, it gives a person something to be encouraged about. Like, at least if I interact with the Qur'an, I learn its meanings, I act upon what it says, فَإِنَّ مَنْزِلَكَ إِنْ دَآخِرَ آيَةٍ تَقْرَأُهَا, it will be the last stage, or the last position of where you will be in the akhirah is where you will then get up to, as in, you know, all the things that you can remember and recite, the things that you acted upon, the things that you knew from the Quran, that will keep elevating you. So in the akhirah, it will be an intercedor. In the akhirah, it will be an elevation. In the akhirah, it will bring tranquility and ease and calmness. In the akhirah, the body that has the Quran inside of it will not touch the fire. Ask Allah to make us and our loved ones from them. Uqba bin Amir radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this has been reported in Ahmad and Darimi, Shaykh al-Albani says the hadith is Hassan. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لو جعل القرآن في إهاب ثم أوقي في النار محترق. If the Quran is inside of a body, let's say, if it exists inside someone, and say that that person is then thrown into the hellfire because of a sin that he has committed, that body will never burn. The Quran is an illumination and it protects against punishment. The Quran also brings about reward on the Day of Judgment, where a person will do very little, and this is part of the barakah that we were talking about, the life of the dunya. But now we're talking about the Quran as a direction of the person in the akhirah. The Quran, a person will come and he will think, where's all this reward come from on the Day of Judgment? And this following hadith, which is reported by Bukhari and Muslim, is actually a lot of good news for a lot of people in this hadith, because there are a lot of people who were not taught how to recite the Quran when they were young, and now they are elder, they are not able to recite the Quran with, you know, fluency, and they struggle, and there's a lot of people that become Muslim, reverts, etc. They struggle. Children struggle. We're trying to teach them the Quran and they struggle. Students of knowledge struggle sometimes, you know. Everyone struggles. But the person who wants to read the Quran, learn the Quran, memorize the Quran, be patient with the Quran, even though they know it's hard, they will come on the Day of Judgment and they will have reward given to them that they didn't anticipate, because they did one action and they thought, okay, well, there's a reward for that action. But in actual fact, the reward will be multiplied for them. Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Mahir bil Quran, the person who is eloquent in reciting the Quran, ma'al safarati, kiramin barra. And this is similar to what we have said before. The person who recites the Quran, he is with those delegates which are noble and pious, meaning the Malaika. The Malaika come down and they are with that person all the time. And inshallah, on the Day of Judgment will be the same. وَالَّذِي يَقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ, and the one who recites the Quran, وَيَتَتَعْتَعَ فِيهِ وَهُوَ عَلَيْهِ شَاقٌ, and he recites the Quran and he stutters with the Quran. It's difficult for him to recite the Quran, but he still is patient. لَهُ أَجْرًا, that person will get two rewards. Remember, nowhere in his explanation of Sahih Muslim, in a nutshell, to summarize what he says, he says that the reward is connected to striving, meaning the person on the Day of Judgment will attain a reward through the Quran, a multiplication of a reward, because of his patience with the Quran, the fact that he strove to learn and recite and read the Quran. These are from some of the things I wanted to mention as an introduction from why this topic is very important. In the dunya, it brings about barakah. Barakah is guidance. Barakah is knowledge. Barakah is ability to act upon that knowledge. Barakah is where a person is moved into darkness, into light. Barakah is where a person does a small amount of good, but he finds that in his life it has a large amount of khayr, goodness. Barakah is where a person does a small amount of good, but he finds that the reward for it is great and vast. Now there's a difference between those two points, because now a person might do a lot of good, but Allah continues to test that person until his reward will finally come, when Allah knows when it will come. But sometimes from the barakah of a person, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his decree and his qadr is just, when the person does good, he will find the reward immediately. And that is not always the case for the same person. Sometimes he goes through ease and sometimes he'll go through difficulty. So the barakah will not be seen right away, it will come later on. And he knows it's coming, so he carries on with hidayah and ilm and interacting with the Quran and interacting with the religion. And then at other times he knows, okay, well, I've done the good, I can see the reward straight away. And that's how God called me. And if he covered, this is how man has been created. Covered, he's good, difficulty, he's difficulty. Therefore, the Quran brings about that khayr. It helps him to increase in goodness, even if he sees the reward right away, or if he doesn't see the reward right away. This is why the Prophet ﷺ said in discussing this point with the companions, that the best of you, O companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are those people who are engaged with the Quran. And this then carries on generation after generation. The Quran is so blessed that when you recite it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase a person in its reward. It is so blessed and it brings about so much blessings for you, and it changes the way you live your life, that even if you were to listen just for it to be recited, it brings about Allah's mercy. It brings about Allah's preservation when a person recites it and listens to it and acts upon it. Because it is the only thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that He will preserve, is the Quran. And then through other evidences we can understand the people of the Quran. من أدمن ما بين الأهيي ورجلي أدمنهم جنة. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever can then guarantee for me that he will protect what is in between his two jaws, meaning his tongue, and what is between his two legs, meaning his private parts, I will then guarantee for that person Jannah. So that guarantee is an extension from the preservation that has been guaranteed to the Quran. There is no other guarantee that has been given in this dunya. الدُّنْيَا مَلْعُونَ. The dunya is cast. The Qur'an creates people of submission, people of akhlaq. The Qur'an brings about the support in the company of the malaika. When a person passes away, the Quran will come to him in his grave. When the person is resurrected, the person will be accompanied with the Quran. The person of Quran will be told to recite and increase and elevate. The person of the Quran will not go into the fire. Now, before we conclude today's lecture, as an introductory to the next few lessons when it comes to the tafsir of Surah Al-Hujurat, I think there's a few very important things that we need to understand as principles in understanding the Quran. Question number one It's all well and good that we say that the Quran is blessed and it takes us away from darkness into light and it does this and it does that. But how do we know that the Quran is true and how do we know that the Quran is factual? How do we know that it is actually real? How do we know that is the truth? Number one, the Quran is the only book, Islam is the only religion which calls to Iman, which calls to the oneness of Allah, which calls to submitting to Him alone, Subhanahu, which calls to attaining His Jannah and His pleasure. We know it is true because it has been trialed and tested. Those people who accept Iman and accept its knowledge, they have been elevated, they have become better, they have become the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves and accepted from. May yuti Allah wa rasulah fa'ulaika, those who obey Allah and His Messenger, then they are the ones that Allah has favored. An'ama Allah alayhim min an-nabiyyin wa siddiqin wa shuhada wa salihin wa hasuna ulaika rafiqa. They are the ones that Allah has favored from the prophets, the siddiqin and the martyrs and the pious, and they are the best companions for you that you could ever have. And the opposite, those people who left Iman, who left that oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they rejected Iman, or when Iman was taken away from them through this Quran, meaning they accepted the book, so they followed it in its ilm, in its practice, they were elevated. Those who rejected it, or accepted it, then rejected it, meaning they turned away from it, look what happened to them also. So look what happened to the people of Quraysh. Look what happened to those people who then ended up disbelieving Muhammad ﷺ after he passed away. We know the Quran is the Quran, it is the word of Allah, it is the truth, because of the fact that it calls to Iman. And there is no other religion that gives you this purpose. There is no other way of life that gives you it. And those people who fulfilled the purpose that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us for, مَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونِ, they were successful. And those people who turned away from it, then they were punished in front of our very own eyes. We know that the Quran is true and factual because there are no contradictions in it. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ غَيْرِ إِنْدِ اللَّهِ لَوَجِلُهُ فِيهِ اخْتِلَافٍ كَثِيرًا. Do they then not contemplate on the Quran? Had it been from other than Allah, they would have found in it many, many contradictions. But there are no contradictions. There are no contradictions when it comes to aqeedah with manhaj, or manhaj with fiqh, or fiqh with aqeedah, or aqeedah with akhlaq. The stories of the prophets, the account of the people of Jannah and the people of Hellfire, all of its messages are simultaneous or consistent. There are no contradictions. Walillahi alhamd. The Quran is the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because it gives a person a way of life. Without it, there will be no ahkam. Without it, there will be no principles. Therefore, it gives us something which is all-encompassing. I mean, there is nothing except that the Quran has given us guidance towards that thing. كتاب أحكمت آيات ثم فصلت من لدن كتاب where he has legislative clear آيات which are then explained. تبيان لكل شيء. We're giving you the book and it is an explanation for everything, every matter. Therefore, we know that the Quran is real because it gives us an all-encompassing way of life. 14, 15 centuries after it was revealed, it is still relevant and it still has the answer for the issues that are facing mankind because of what is there and the principles that are found and the rulings that are found within it. We know that the Quran is the word of Allah and it is the truth because it challenges a person to find fault in it or to create something like it. And if they are not able to do so, then they will have to admit that this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uncreated. And there are many ayat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, bring one surah like it. فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِثْلِ وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Give me one surah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Hud, give me 10 ayat. Still can't do that. Give me one ayah. Still can't do that. Therefore, it challenges the opposition to produce something like it, to produce faults in it. Mankind have never been able to do that. Quraysh were never able to do that. The people that understood the Quran being revealed with its context, with Muhammad ﷺ being there, the munafiqun, the people of the book, also were alive and present whilst the Quran was being revealed, and they were not able to find any faults in it. Therefore, the Quran is saying, if this is wrong, then show where it is wrong. And if it is not wrong, then there is a mistake with you, the person who is trying to find faults in it or not believing in it. Now a person will say, well, this is the Arabic language and somebody could probably create something like the Quran, especially after it was revealed. Then the challenge here is talking about what the Quran is and what the Quran does, not just the semantics and not just the wording. So now we have Alif Lam Mim, Dhalika Kitabu La Rayba Fi. That sentence, can a person who knows the Arabic language, who is very eloquent in the Arabic language, you know, a grammarian, etc., can he come out with a sentence like that? Can he come out with poetry, which perhaps there's a lot of poetry which is, you know, very thought-provocative, very charismatic in the way that they are issued, the way that they are said, the way that they are performed. The message is sometimes quite profound. However, the challenge here that the Quran is bringing is not just about the semantics. Number one, the Quran actually came to formalize the religion, the Arabic language anyway. Before that, the Arabic language was, there was no formality to it at all. There were different dialects, there were different. So when the Quran came, it gave the standard for the Arabic Fusha. That's point number one if we're just looking at it semantically. But the ulama have mentioned here that the challenge to try and find fault in the Quran talks about aqidah, talks about manhaj, talks about way of life. Everything that we have mentioned before, really. Find fault in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent after the anbiya, one and after the other. Find fault in the belief in Jannah, the belief in the Hellfire, the belief in the Malaika, try and find fault in any aspect of it. Or try and give an alternative to it. So okay, if the Malaika are not real, if Allah is not real, if the pillars of faith are not real, if the ahkam and the aspects of the religion are real, so then give us something which is better then. If Islam is not real, you formulate your religion for us then. Can you do that? Until now, mankind have not been able to do that. And in actual fact, people were given a book and they distorted the book, and now they've just been spiraling away from that initial book that they had in the first place. So even if you were given a head start, even if you were given, so to speak, a head start, it's not a head start, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not want them to corrupt the book. But say they had been given a manual, and then they ended up twisting that manual according to their own needs anyway, to try and formulate something for themselves, they would never be able to improve what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed in the first place. And this is the only book. Now a person will say, okay, well, if the Jews were given the Torah and the Nasara were given, the Christians were given the Injil, how is it that they were then able to twist and distort and move away from their books? This is the answer to that. It's quite simple. Allah says in our Quran, which has not been revealed about any other book before that, I will quote it before, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. We will reveal upon you the dhikr. We have revealed upon you the dhikr, and we will preserve it. That has not been revealed by any other book before. Therefore, when we fuse all of that together, then we can understand that this is preservation from Allah, and that's how we know that it's the haqq. It's tawheed, it's aqeedah, it's iman, it's rulings, it's consistency in following the Prophet after the Prophet. It's calling us to the Akhirah. It's calling us to become better. It's calling us to have submission and humility in front of Allah. أنتم فقراء إلى الله والله غني وحميد. Allah, you are poor and weak in front of Allah. Allah is غني. He is the rich one, he doesn't need you. He's independent and he's al-Hamid, he can praise himself. He doesn't need you to praise him. Therefore, the Quran has absolutely nothing wrong with it. And if someone tries to find fault with it, then the problem is with themselves rather than the Quran. And this is how we know that the Quran is factual. And from the things that the ulama have mentioned, is that if you have something of poetry and you have something of Quran, the effects of the Quran on the heart, the mind, the soul, the person's life is absolutely astounding. It cannot be compared to anything else from the speech of man. Malik ibn Dinar, rahimahullah, one of the tabi'een, he said, إِنَّ السُّدِّيقِينَ إِذَا قُرِعَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقُرْآنِ. Surely the truthful people, the people who have that truthfulness inside towards Allah, towards His religion, when the Qur'an is recited to them, طُرِبَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ إِلَى الْآخِرَةِ. Their hearts are pushed forward, their hearts begin to yearn the Akhirah more than anything else. Can the same be said about anything else? No matter how eloquent a speech is, no matter how moving a speech is, most of that is only connected to the life of this dunya. Therefore, we know the truthfulness of the Quran because of the effects that it brings upon the person who wants to understand it. They have to be from the Siddiqeen, as Malik ibn Dinar here says, rahimahullah. They want to learn, they believe in it, they believe in its meanings and its messages. It's tawheed, it's aqeedah, the fact that there is nur in it and it's there to take me away from the darkness. The effects that it will have on the heart and the soul and the body cannot be compared to anything else. That now concludes question number one. Now inshallah, hopefully we have affirmed that the Quran is the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from different viewpoints. Number two, why has Allah given us the Quran? Is it to recite the Quran? Is it to beautify the Quran?
Is it to learn the Quran? Is it to learn the Quran and not act upon the Quran? These are all rhetorical. I think we know what the answer is. And we've kind of established it already. Allah has given us the Quran so that we believe in it. We learn it. We act upon it. And we seek to elevate and get closer towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through it and by it. Because there's nothing in the face of this dunya except that it is created. The only thing that is uncreated inside the creation of Allah is His speech. The only thing which is eternal and has no beginning and no end inside of the creation that we can see is His speech. Me and you, we have a beginning and an end. The Quran doesn't. It's from the knowledge of Allah. إِنَّمَا أُنزِلَ بِإِلْمِ اللَّهِ وَأَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُ. Surely it's been revealed with the ilm of Allah, and there is no deity that is worthy of worship except Him. The Quran is from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore it cannot be created. So if it is from Allah and it is not created, that means it is from eternity subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knew the Quran in eternity, subhanahu. For the only thing inside of this creation, which is eternal, the only thing which is inside of this creation, which has no beginning and end, not created, is the Quran. So in order for us, the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the Quran is so that we can benefit ourselves to get closer to Him with that uncreated speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what is unfortunate, look at this hadith of the Prophet. Again, Uqba ibn Amir radiallahu anhu. And this has been narrated in Mu'ajim al-Kabir and has been graded as Sahih by Shaykh al-Rabani. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سَيَخْرُجْ أَقْوَامٌ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي. There will be a group of people. Now this group could be large, it could be small. And arguably I would say this is a large group today. سَيَخْرُجْ أَقْوَامٌ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي. There will be people, there will be nations that will come. There will be people that emerge from my ummah. يَشْرَبُونَ الْقُرْآنَ كَمَا شُرْبِهِمْ اللَّبَنَ. يَشْرَبُونَ الْقُرْآنَ كَشُرْبِهِمْ اللَّبَنَ. They will drink the Qur'an as they drink milk. How can you drink the Qur'an as you drink milk? The ulama have explained this hadith means that people will engage with the Qur'an in an inappropriate and incorrect manner. Either it will just be about recitation and not understanding. Either it will be about recitation and beautifying that recitation, but not about understanding. Either it will be about recitation and understanding, but not about action. Either it could be about action, but not understanding. So now they will look at the apparent ayat, implement it, but perhaps not have the correct understanding. It could be about having the understanding and having the action, but not reciting. يشربون القرآن كشربهم اللبن. In another narration, كشربهم الماء. They will just drink it, it will go down into their bodies, and then that's it. There is no actual penetration into the soul, into the submission and the humility of that person who is reciting the Quran. Has it actually changed that person or not? Allah has given you something which is eternal and uncreated to elevate you, but it depends on how you are going to interact with it. Are you going to learn it? Are you going to act upon it? Are you going to recite it? Are you going to memorize it? Are you going to devote some time of your day towards it or not? And the more you increase in that, the more you increase in goodness. But the more you just put it in the background, the more you just think, oh, that's a really nice recitation, let me just enjoy that recitation and find it soothing. يَشْرَبُونَ الْقُرْآنَ كَشُرْبِهِمْ الْمَاءِ. They are not using the Qur'an in the right way. They are consuming it just like they will consume any other thing to suffice and fulfill their desires. Why has Allah given you the Qur'an? to take you away from darkness and put you into light. Question number three. Now, before we go into the tafsir of Surah Al-Hujarat, this question, the next three questions are very important in relation to this series. Number one, or question number three, is there a difference between tafsir and lessons that we can ponder from the Quran and its ayat? Now, this is very important because it's not just the English language, it's in almost every single language that you find people talking about the Quran, but none of it is tafsir. Some of it is their own reflections, some of it is their own personal experiences, some of it is the linguistic understanding, some of it is just made up, to be honest. We find a lot of that. Therefore, in order for us to counter all of these different forms of deviation that is happening with people's interaction with the Quran and different manhaj and the different, what we need to understand now is that is there a difference between tafsir and lessons? Now, at this point, we have to understand nobody is condemning the fact that you don't draw lessons from the Quran. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا كِتَابَ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ مُبَارَكًا لِيَدَبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to ponder. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ الْآيَاتِ لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ الْآيَاتِ لِلْعَالَمِينَ وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ. There are so many ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, engage with the Quran, benefit from the Quran, extrapolate and deduce from the Quran, but is that tafsir or not tafsir? There are so many things that we could be saying about this. I'll just quote one statement here from Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, an Imam from the A'imma from Ahl al-Sunnah, Imam al-Aqidah, Imam al-Fiqh, Imam al-Hadith, Imam al-Tafsir, Imam al-Lugha. There is no field except that he was an Imam, to the extent that it is well known that he had his own madhab. Mujtahid mutlaq, rahimahullah. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. He is very well known for his authoring of his tafsir, and he says in there, غَيْرُ جَائِزْ, and it is not permissible, تَرْكْ الظَّاهِرَ الْمَفْهُومِ مِنَ الْكَلَامِ إِلَىٰ بَاطِنْ لَا دَلَالَ أَلَىٰ صِحَّتِهِ. It is not permissible for a person to take what is apparent from the Quran and to move towards something which is hidden, except if you've got dalil for that lesson and that pondering. And there's so many things that we can say, and even the next statement that we will gain from Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah is kind of connected to this, inshallah, anyway. But I think this is sufficient. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari rahimahullah is saying, in order for you to draw lessons from the Quran, it must be based upon dalil. Tafsir of the Qur'an is based upon dalil. Therefore, when a person wants to understand what is the meaning in this ayah, in this word, in this surah, in this whole Qur'an, from the beginning to the end, how do we understand tafsir? Tafsir means the explanation of the Qur'an. It has to be based on evidence. It can't be based on your own reasoning. It can't be based on your own thoughts. It can't be based on politics. It can't be based on spirituality. It has to be based on dalil. Because all of those things could be wrong. All of those lessons could be wrong. That's not the benchmark. The benchmark is dalil. Dalil explains dalil. That's how the Sharia works. However, if you want to then deduce things, nobody is saying that you don't, but it has to be in conformance with the dalil. Therefore, if there are lessons, it is dependent upon the tafsir. That's question number three. So there is a difference between tafsir and there is a difference between tafsir and lessons. Tafsir is based upon evidences. The Quran explains the Quran, the Sunnah explains the Quran, the companions explain the Quran, the tabi'in, the students of the companions, they explain the Quran. That is tafsir. So anything from those sources there, that is tafsir of the Quran. However, if a person wants to then deduce something for himself, or look at the times we're living, pandemic we're living, etc., maybe this ayah can apply to us living here. Yes, perhaps you can do that, but it has to be based upon the tafsir. And if it is not, then we can't do that. Question number four. Can we ponder on the Qur'an without its evidence is being confirmed to us? So now, this question is a bit different to the previous one, because the previous one is saying, if I know the tafsir, I can ponder on it. That's fine. And then I can say safely that this is a lesson that I can draw from this ayah because it conforms with the tafsir. This is a lesson which doesn't conform with the tafsir, therefore this lesson is X. It's not valid. The next question now, and this is what Ibn Taymiyyah is talking about now, rahimahullah, is that do we have a license to ponder? Do we have a license to talk about the Qur'an without knowing its tafsir? Ibn Taymiyyah says in Majmu' al-Fatawa, بَلْ يَنْظُرْ فِي كُلِّ آيَةٍ وَحَدِيثٍ بِخُصُوصِهِ وَسِيَاقِهِ وَمَا يُبَيِّنْ مَعْنَى مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ وَالدَّلَالَاتِ فَهَذَا أَصْلٌ أَذِيمٌ مُهِمٌ نافع في باب فهم الكتاب والسنة والاستدلال بهما مطلقا. Quite lengthy that, let me explain. Rather, it is binding on upon the person to look at every single ayah or every single hadith in what is specific to that ayah and to that hadith. As in, look at the background of that ayah, look at the background of that hadith, look at the context, and then look at what will help us understand that ayah or the hadith from its evidences. So we look at different evidences. Like we said before, the Qur'an will explain the Qur'an, the Qur'an will be explained by the hadith, the Qur'an will be explained by the statements of the companions and the salaf, etc. And this is what a person must do. And then he says, this is an extremely important, beneficial principle in trying to understand the kitab and the sunnah and the evidences found in the kitab and the sunnah in absolute terms. وَنَافِعٌ and it's beneficial فِي مَعْرِفَةَ الْإِسْتِدْلَالِ وَالْإِعْتِرَادِ وَالْجَوَابِ وَتَرْدِ الدَّلِيلِ وَنَقْدِهِ. Then he goes on to say, I mean, in order for us to understand what is real and what is not, what is factual, what is not, what is correct, what is not, what is objective and what is subjective, from the evidences, all of it goes back to giving the evidences its justice. So now, from question number three and question number four, what we can understand is that tafsir is extremely important, but it comes with guidelines. Pondering is very important, but it has its own place. And there is no such thing as a person talking about the Qur'an which is not in line with the tafsir. Last question before we go on to start talking about Surah Al-Hujarat. And this is actually an aqidah-based question. Are all the ayat from the Qur'an the same? Meaning, is تبت يا أبي لهب وتب the same as قل هو الله أحد or not? Prophet ﷺ clearly told us in the hadith, قل هو الله أحد, سورة الإخلاص تعدل ثلث القرآن, it is equivalent to a third of the Quran. Is that the same as تبت يا أبي لهب? Now some of the أشاعرة, and generally speaking, the people who say that the Qur'an is created, not the speech of Allah, may Allah protect us from that belief, will believe that all of the Qur'an is the same. Why? Because it's created. It's all created. So some of the ulama have said, some of the madahib and the sects have said that all of the Qur'an is the same. Ahlul Sunnah believe no. Ayatul Kursi is the best ayah in the Qur'an. Surah Al-Fatiha is the best surah in the Qur'an. The Prophet ﷺ said, اقرأوا, recite. Al-Baqarah wal-Al-Imran, recite Al-Baqarah wal-Al-Imran. فَإِنَّهُمَا يَتِيَانِ, they will come on the day of judgment like a large bird covering him as a protection. Surah Al-Mulk is Al-Mani'ah. It protects a person from being punished in the grave. It's
talks about intercedor. اقرأوا المولدتين, recite the فرق الناس, because then there is a ruqya and there is a preventative and is a cure. Therefore, not all of the Quran is the same. Imam al-Suyuti in his book Al-Itqan fi Ulum al-Quran, the book is called Itqan, as in proficiency in the sciences of the Quran. He said, اختلف القائلون بالتفضيل. Some of the ulama have differed as to how can we then understand which ayah is better than another ayah. So some of the ulama have said, الفضل راجع إلى أعظم الأجر. So those that bring about more reward, if we've got evidences for those rewards, they are better ayat and they are better surahs. Others from the ulama, and this has been mentioned by Imam al-Tabari, he said, the ayat which bring about ahkam are better than the ayat which do not bring about ahkam, meaning the ayat which are muhkam, which give us legislative rulings, etc., that we can still practice, they are better than those that which have been abrogated or can't be applied. Sheikh al-Shinqiti, rahimahullah, sahib Adwa al-Bayan, he said, some surahs and ayat are better because of the ease in a person being able to practice them, and it is not just based upon reward or the lack of reward, or reward or punishment. Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, and others from the ulama, have said, بحسب انفعالات النفس وخشيتها وتدبرها وتفكرها إن الورود أوصاف العلم. It is actually connected. The ayat which are better than one another are connected to those. Yes, reward is definitely an aspect. So now nobody can say that a particular ayah is better than Ayatul Kursi, because we know Ayatul Kursi is the best ayah from the Quran. However, other ayat and other surahs, how do we know that one is better than another? And again, there is no conclusive argument to this. There is no conclusive answer. It's just to make sure that we are exploring different views from the ulama. And from what the ulama have mentioned here, this has been mentioned by Ibn Taymiyyah and al-Suyuti as well himself in Itqan, that those ayat which have more of a profound benefit on a person, those which help a person to understand and ponder and deduce and change and reflect, those ayat are better for that person, because that is bringing about the actual reason for why the person has been given the Quran. This is not to say that a person neglects other ayat, or he creates innovation connected to those ayat which he thinks are good. But this is just to say that some ayat can be better than other ayat. So now if he's reading the Quran, but then he comes across an ayah or a surah which he very much is moved by, in that context, Ibn Taymiyyah and Imam al-Suyuti are saying, may Allah have mercy on them both, that is a time where a person is going to actually benefit from the Quran more than any other time that he has recited it. Because this point here is going to do something to him. This is not to say that he creates innovations or that he rejects other parts. Now the reason why we're mentioning this is to then confirm, yes, some ayat are better than ayat, some surahs are better than other surahs. This is the belief of Ahlul Sunnah, and we've got plenty of evidence, as we said. The Prophet ﷺ told us to recite Baqarah and Imran, Ayatul Kursi, Ikhlas, Falak al-Nas, etc. What's the point of that? The point of that is Surah Al-Hujarat. With some of the ulama, they've called it Surah Al-Akhlaq. And acting upon that final question and the answer from it is that some surahs are better than other surahs, then a person will think, okay, well, why have we selected Surah Al-Hujarat to be the only surah that we will cover in this series? Isn't it a bit random, just right in the middle, surah number 49 from the Quran? Where? What about surah number 1 or surah number 114? Wouldn't it be better if we start from somewhere around there? Ahl al-Sunnah, and as we find with the ulama, those ayat which are easier, those ayat which are more relevant, those ayat which can be practiced immediately, those ayat which will bring about khair, immediate khair, an increase of iman, they are better for the person who is reciting the Quran at that time than other ayat. So it could be at a time that you're going through difficulty and you read through what Ayyub alayhi salam went through. At that time, those ayat are better for you than something else. Therefore, Surah Al-Hujurat, being known as Surah Al-Hujurat, also known as Surah Al-Akhlaq, is something which is relevant and important to the time that we live in, to the discussion that we've been having recently, and the need for the Ummah for it. Because the theme of this surah is about manners. To the extent that some of the ulama have said that nearly every single line of this surah has either an implicit or explicit do or don't, which will help the character of the person who is reading it, the person who wants that hidayah, the person who wants to act upon it. So just in the beginning of the surah, لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله, do not put yourself in front of Allah or above Allah and His Messenger. Do not think that your opinion is better than theirs. Do not think, okay, well, they've said something, but I'm going to do something else. لا تقدم. Don't. لا ترفعوا أصواتكم. Do not raise your voices. ولا تجهروا له بالقول. And do not, shout, and do not, So just in the first few ayat, we are finding, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that. Become better. You're better than this. You are good. But we also have commands. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ فَتَبَيِّنُوا. Confirm. فَأَصْلِحُوا وَأَقْسِطُوا. The surah throughout is giving us instructions and commands to implement in order for us to improve in our character. Verify. Seek betterment. Create unity and brotherhood. وَأَقْسِطُوا. Be just. It tells us to stay away from other things throughout the surah. So we've seen, لَا تُقَدِّمُوا وَلَا تَرْفَعُوا وَلَا تَجْهَرُوا. لَا يَسْخَرْ. Don't mock. وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا. Do not make nicknames. Do not insult one another. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا. Do not spy. Do not be suspicious. وَلَا يَغْتَبْ. Do not backbite one another. Therefore, this surah is important, and it kind of confirms everything that we've been talking about in this introduction, in a person wanting to seek barakah, in a person wanting to seek rewards, in a person wanting to have an elevated status in the akhirah, to be accompanied by the malaika, to attain Allah's Jannah and His rewards and His pleasure, to know that the Quran is true and factual, to understand its evidences, and rather than just drinking the Quran, to understand in this series now, inshallah, what tafsir is and what lessons are, and that some have a more of a relevance in a person's life over others, because in this surah we will understand the rights of Allah, the rights of His names and His attributes, the rights of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the rights of your brothers and your sisters, the rights over yourself in controlling your tongue, in controlling your behavior, in controlling your iman, the rights of ilm, and how this religion prohibits us from falling into ignorance and gossiping and rumoring. And this surah also teaches us to have sabr and to remove harm. This surah also tells us to confirm and deliberate and to be careful. This surah removes from people nifaq and instills in them a sidq. Therefore, this has been the introduction of Surah Al-Hujurat, and inshaAllah, bi'awnillah, next week, inshaAllah, we'll begin the tafsir of the surah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us tawfiq and to grant us success, and that He makes us the people of Quran. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has mercy on us through the Quran. And that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He makes it as an illumination for our hearts. And that through it, our anxieties and our worries and our distresses are removed. Likewise, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He elevates us through the Quran. And that He makes us of those who understand its wording and they implement it. And not those people who do not understand it. And they move away from its guidelines and its instructions. هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.